evening, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Reasonable Doubt. I'm your host, Jimmy Ardoin. We are, as always, brought to you by the Harris County Criminal Lawyers Association. Along with me tonight, my co-host, Julio Vela. What's going on, man?
Jimmy, how you doing?
Good. It's just the two of us tonight.
Just the two of us. Just the two of us. Call in. You got questions? Come on. Tweet.
Exactly.
Call in.
We're going to open up the phone lines. Around 8:30 tonight, 713-807-1794 is our number. We got Twitter going, at HCCLA_TV. Hit us up on there. You got questions, you got comments for Julio and I. We'll take them right here on the air. Let's delve right into it, Julio. Big week in the Supreme Court. We had some more opinions coming out today, of course. The immigration decision came down today. You had the Abigail Fisher drama still going on
right.
8 years later. That decision came down. But most notably this week for criminal justice was another erosion of our Fourth Amendment rights. And it's the Utah versus Strife, I guess that's how you say it, Strife case. What got the most attention, of course, was Justice Sotomayor's dissent. And we'll get to that in a moment. But basically the crux of this thing is a gentleman in Utah is illegally pulled over. The police had set up on what was ostensibly a drug house, and they had been watching people coming and going from the house, and this cop just decided to try and pull this guy over. It wasn't a valid stop, and of course, they find drugs in the car after he places him under arrest and everything. And essentially, as he's doing the search, he comes up that the guy has an open warrant, I guess a ticket. So he had a warrant, so that justified putting him under arrest, which led to the inventory search of the vehicle and the discovery of the drugs. So it goes up on appeal. Of course, you know, typically the exclusionary rule says fruit of the poisonous tree. If it's a bad stop, everything else should go away. But not in this case. Supreme Court said this week that an illegal stop, if you've got open warrants, it's valid reason, and the impetus for the arrest, the illegal stop, it's washed away. If they had a valid reason to place you under arrest, despite an illegal stop, it's not fruit of the poisonous tree.
For initially, as what the law, what we understood it to be, up until I guess today or yesterday or this week, was so in order for you, an individual, to be free. To go from free to cuffed required first a reasonable suspicion that a crime had been committed. So the officer generally would have to say, he didn't use his blinker, or he was weaving from lane to lane and causing an unsafe environment for other drivers, or you got in a wreck, or your tags are out.
Or even in this case, had he seen a hand-to-hand delivery.
Or he saw a hand-to-hand delivery, or even being in a suspicious place. There had to have been some sort of reasonable suspicion. A reasonable articulate fact that warranted that there's crime might be afoot. So once the officer establishes reasonable suspicion, he can then make contact with you. Say, let me see your driver's license, let me see your insurance. And from there, if the facts allowed him to, he could create probable cause and then cuff you. However, in this scenario, and what the Supreme Court says now is, hey, you know what? Even if you don't use a turn signal, even if I don't see you do a hand-to-hand transaction, if, you know, you're just driving around and I decide to say, hey, I'm going to pull this guy over and have no reasonable suspicion to do so, I can do that. So that way I can go ahead and run his name and check you for a warrant or check him for a warrant. And if one pops up, hey, I get to arrest you. And what that does is what I understood it, the Supreme Court to say is that it breaks the chain of illegal conduct that allows them to cuff you.
And what's interesting in this case, I think, is the facts. Because it's one of those situations where I'm amazed that it was this case that drew the ruling that it did, because this police officer had basically gotten an anonymous tip about a drug house. It was in Salt Lake City. And so he watched the house over the course of a week or so. He would go out there and watch what was going on. And people would come in, leave, and, you know, he had witnessed people who had short visits. And theoretically, that could be enough for reasonable suspicion, because he could say, in my experience as a police officer, he could certainly fill out an affidavit. I mean, if they wanted to get a search warrant for the house, he could probably go to a magistrate and say, look, I set up on this house for a week. I witnessed people coming in and out in with very short visits to the house. In my experience, based on my personal experience and knowledge as a police officer, I believe that to be an indicia of drug activity. Mm-hmm. And that probably would have gotten a search warrant for the house in just in front of about just any judge you can think of. But the interesting thing here is he says that the strife, the ultimate defendant in this case, he never saw him enter the house. So he couldn't tell, he couldn't, you know, opine how long he had been in the house.
Right.
So there was no reasonable suspicion to pull strife over. And I guess that's what made them want to take the case, because there was no reasonable suspicion. And that's what makes it, I guess for me, the hard part is we were always taught the exclusionary rule, again, fruit of the poisonous tree. But it's been under attack for 30 plus years.
Right.
Going back to the Reagan administration, I mean, they have really sought to limit, if not eradicate, the exclusionary rule under the Fourth Amendment. And so, you know, this decision is really troubling to me.
The idea that in order for an officer to restrain a free individual's liberty is that they have to follow A plus B equals trouble. And when you get to the ends through a runaround or through cheating, in other words, violating someone's, what we would formally believe to be their constitutional rights, anything they find should be what, quote unquote, bad fruit. It shouldn't be admitted in court. It's prejudice. And we have the exclusionary rule excluding evidence found in contrary to the laws or the Constitution. We have that to deter future violations by law enforcement or by the government. And so now I'm wondering, what are the grander implications of this ruling? So I'm kind of thinking to myself, does it only apply? So officer pulls you over just because he literally just feels like he should be pulling you over,
mm-hmm.
for any sort of pretextual reason. Oh, I don't like that car. That car looks funny in this neighborhood. Or, oh, did you, you know, you know what? I'm just going to pull him over because I feel like pulling him over. And I'm wondering if it is it just the warrant check? Or are there other means that will attenuate the that will cause the attenuation analysis to come into play? So I don't know.
Well, it's like you said, the discovery of the warrant broke the causal chain,
right?
Between the unconstitutional stop and the discovery of evidence. Okay, my issue with it is you had a bad stop from the beginning.
Bad stop.
You know, and this is only going to encourage officers to make bad stops on a fishing expedition.
Right.
To go out and see, like, hey, well, this guy's riding around in a beat up jalopy. You know, maybe something's going on here. Maybe I can find something. You know, and maybe I can get this guy. He might be more likely to have an outstanding traffic warrant. And
That was
the point of Sotomayor's dissent, which she came out just, you know, fists with some haymakers at him, that this was going to adversely impact minority communities big time. It's going to affect poor people big time, because those are the two biggest groups who are going to be affected, A, by just being pulled over in general, and two, having a likelihood of having outstanding traffic tickets or outstanding warrants. I mean, look how many people get rounded up in these traffic warrants. And even the poor people are more likely to have outstanding warrants, yes. But I think there's a great number of people just in the population in general, like, they just don't take care of tickets.
I was going to the SOA office the other day, and I get pulled over. It's 8:30 in the morning or 8:20, and I'm rushing to SO office. Officer says I was speeding. I wasn't speeding. I'm going on the record, one speeding.
Right.
But in any event, I have a traffic ticket. And so let's say I'm cruising around in my ride, and I'm not suited down. And an officer says, hey, look at this guy in this neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
Pull him over. He pulls me over, runs, and obviously he's not going to, I don't ever ride dirty, so I don't have to worry about that. But, okay, so then he runs my name. I have a speeding citation out there. And come on, get out of the car. And just as Sotomayor said, you're going to have someone touch you, frisk you.
Yep.
You're going to have maybe the humiliation of your neighborhood or people that are driving by watching you being stopped by an officer. You're going to have this idea that you've been prosecuted or you've been held up by the police. So you have some mental, emotional issue there, some trauma there. And just the idea of all of this happening without reasonable suspicion for a stop or anything of the like is unjust, and it shouldn't happen. And I think that's what is most concerning to me, at least. Now, do I think that an officer is going to look at a black dude or a Mexican dude and decide to pull him over, and then this Mexican or black dude is going to be more likely to have a traffic citation than a white dude? I don't necessarily know, but I do know that there's 67 million people out there or so who have traffic citations or traffic warrants out there, and suddenly, what shouldn't be an issue in the first place, they're getting themselves searched and their car.
Well, and think about how many teenagers, young adults, this could happen to. College-age students. I mean, how many times in college do you just, you get a citation, you forget about it, you have to pay it later, you know, you got to pay the warrant to get out of it, kind of thing. You don't want to tell your parents. I can see this being a real issue with when it comes down to what happens on campus, too.
Right.
Because remember, I don't know if it still goes on, but a lot of times we had parties where there was underage drinking. There's all sorts of stuff going on. And what if you have a scenario like this where the cops set up on a party looking for underage drinking, and they go and approach, but they have no reasonable suspicion. And they go up there and they just suspect underage drinking is going on, and they do kind of a similar setup,
mm-hmm.
you know. But you have a situation where then what are you going to have? A bunch of potential 18, 19, 20-year-olds who get arrested because they got outstanding warrants?
And everybody show me your IDs.
Right.
Run them all. We're running everybody. Officer, you have no reason to be here.
Well, and then what if they got marijuana?
Adderall.
Adderall. You know, a lot of college students, they have prescription drugs, Adderall, Ritalin, all that sort of stuff. No prescription for it.
Right.
And I just see this as being opening a possible Pandora's box.
Well, I can only imagine the cross-examination of that officer. Judge, we need to exclude this evidence based on fruit of the poisonous tree. Officer so-and-so, did my client make a wrong turn? No. Did he use his turn signal? Yes. Was he weaving from side to side? No. Did he look intoxicated? No. Did he hit a curb? No. So you stopped him over for no, or you pulled him over or made contact with him for no other reason just because you did? Yes. Did he violate the law in any way? No. Nothing further. No reasonable suspicion for the stop. Judge, we should win this case. But now he gets to say, well, and then I ran his driver's license, and it came out that he had a warrant, and then I put him under arrest, and I searched him, and I found the drugs. And you're sitting there like, well, Judge, the interaction between him and the officer, the client and the officer, needs some sort of constitutional justification in certain contexts. I don't know.
Well, and for those, obviously, who are watching who aren't lawyers, the exclusionary rule is not in and of itself in the Fourth Amendment.
Right.
It's not in the Constitution. It is not, you don't have a constitutional right to have evidence excluded. It is a creature of judicial case law. It was made by the Supreme Court. Essentially, what they said was, you have a Fourth Amendment right to be free from unreasonable search and seizure. And so what the court did was they said, along those lines, because of that, if you have an illegal stop, you know, from if you have no reasonable suspicion, if you have an illegal stop, you've had no probable cause, but then somewhere along the way they discover evidence against you, incriminating evidence against you, well, it has to all be thrown out. Again, fruit of the poisonous tree doctrine. And so to me, that's a logical argument. It is logical that in order to be free from unreasonable search and seizure, that you should also be free from being prosecuted if the cop does something that results in an unreasonable search or seizure of you. And I don't know how you can sit there and say it's reasonable to illegally stop someone, but oh, if in the interim you find out they have an arrest warrant, then if the drugs you find, well, we can go prosecute you for that. It doesn't seem reasonable to me.
It doesn't. And it used to be that, you know, the case, you make that legal argument, you can show the proper facts to prove up your submission, and that the bad fruit gets excluded and you win your case. But now I think what's going to have to happen is, this is one of the scenarios where your justice bone just says, dang, and they're going to go to trial. And so now we're going to be sitting in front of a jury saying, hey, look, this is wrong. He had no reason to stop the guy. The cop had no, he didn't do anything wrong, but the cop stopped him. And yeah, you know, this X, Y, and Z happens. And, you know, he had some drugs in his pocket, or he had some contraband or things he shouldn't have had in his car. And a lot of times that's a tough sell to a jury, because the jury says, well, he had it anyways, didn't he? I'd hope that.
Yeah, but
it doesn't happen like that.
But I think with this ruling, and I'm not an appellate lawyer, so I'd certainly, you know, be nice to have any appellate lawyers call in with your opinions. But it seems to me that based on this ruling, you're not going to get that instruction from a jury. And the instruction I'm talking about, ladies and gentlemen, is under the Code of Criminal Procedure, 38.23 says that if the jury believes there was no reasonable suspicion or probable cause, they're instructed to throw the case out, essentially. That's what it boils down to. That's not the legalese of it, but in simplistic terms, it's a you can ask for the instruction at the end of the case when the evidence is submitted to the jury. If you believe you've put in evidence that there was an illegal stop or that the search was unreasonable or lacked reasonable suspicion or lacked probable cause, you're allowed to ask, and you may not get it from the judge, but you're allowed to ask for the 3823, what we call the 3823 instruction, to be submitted to the jury. And I don't think you get it anymore with this.
I don't think you get it either. I didn't think about that, but I think that's, you know, basically it's used to say like, hey, look, this evidence was taken in contrary to the United States Constitution, violated our rights, and therefore, jury, if you believe beyond a reasonable doubt that that has happened, you have to acquit the defendant.
It's basically like getting a second bite of the apple from a motion to suppress hearing, where the judge could rule on it and say, let the jury decide, kind of thing.
I don't think you get it now.
I don't think you do, because I need more clarification.
Oh, sorry.
But no, it's all right. I think that's the way it's set up.
Oh, I thought it said phone.
No. Yeah. We're all good. I'm getting used to this two-shot thing. But I think that, you know, it's one of those situations where the judge could say, look, I'm not giving you the instruction because I believe there was that causal break, you know, that there was a break in the chain. And so, no, I'm not going to give it to you.
Man, that's bad news, fellas. It's bad news.
And I think that would hold up.
It's bad news.
You know, we got Bob Longoria tweeting in, you guys are in trouble. If there's no exclusionary rule, if the Fourth Amendment can be willingly, willfully violated, what are you doing? You know, it's true. I mean, what is our role at that point?
Wow. Well, okay. So
I mean, we're kind of the last line of defense.
Oh, man. So
to make the argument.
Yeah. So the client will have to be squeaky clean. Or you're just, you're like, no warrants out, no tickets, no. I mean, which most of us are, okay? But in reality, the most people that are end up getting charged, most of them, a lot of them.
I'd say well over 75%.
Most of them aren't squeaky clean. They got a traffic ticket warrant. They got a failure to appear. They got something out there.
There's something else that's just, makes it an imperfect situation.
And so what are you supposed to do now? Wow, that's amazing. So the same thing would happen with, okay, so I don't like the cut of this guy's jib. Pull him over. No reasonable suspicion to pull him over anyways. They get his license, and then they arrest him for DWI.
Well, and it's already
drugs.
It was already hard enough with the good faith exception.
Right.
In a lot of cases to prove, to win a motion to suppress. And then, of course, you also had the issue. I mean, a perfect example I had in a case where the dispatch had said, well, there's a black SUV that just left the scene of a hit and run. So cops are going southbound. My client's going northbound in a dark SUV. You know, that was the only description. So what do they do? Boo! You know, whip around and go pull him over. And, you know, there's no signs on the SUV of a hit and run, but there were two cops in the car, and one cop had made contact with the driver while the other cop was circling the car, and that first cop smelled alcohol in the client's breath.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
So there was no reasonable suspicion.
Nope.
They got a very vague,
yeah, right.
They got a very vague description from the dispatch. But what are you going to do?
Wow.
You can't win that, because clearly once he approaches, I mean, they're going to rule. I didn't think it was reasonable suspicion, but the court thought it was.
Mm-hmm.
The court thought it was absolutely reasonable suspicion to approach him. We lost on that issue.
Well, and it's the same thing. And so what happens when you say, no, I'm not going to give you my ID. You have no reason to make contact with me. There's no reasonable suspicion for you. And this isn't some casual encounter. This isn't some knock and talk. It's a detainment for reasonable suspicion purposes. And he says, well, give me your ID. And you no, I don't want to give you my ID. Well, then you're going to get charged with failure to identify. It's almost like, okay, here's my ID. I know I got a traffic warrant, and I know I got some stuff in the book. And so you're screwed. And then you go hire a lawyer, and, you know, the old arguments that were based on principle, based on law, is going to get flipped upside down.
Well, and the reality is the Fourth Amendment has been under assault, like I said, for a long time. This isn't the first time that we've had bad rulings on the Fourth Amendment. I mean, God, can you imagine if Scalia was still in the court, how bad this ruling would have been? I think
right.
It would have been much more broad, because Thomas actually wrote the opinion.
Mm-hmm.
I truly believe that had Scalia still been around, he would have been the lead on this opinion.
You know,
this is right up his alley. And he would have probably written a much more broad opinion that would have been, frankly, I don't know how, but it probably would have been worse for us as criminal defense lawyers.
I wonder if these people, these highly intelligent, respectable people, just been sitting on an ivory tower for so long.
Well, yeah, that's exactly it. Don't you remember, though, when they had that debate and Chief Justice John Roberts said he had never been stopped by police before?
That's right.
So, I mean, that's the issue you have, and he got called out for that by Sotomayor. I mean, what do you mean to tell me you've never been pulled over by the police? What kind of world do you live in that you have never in your life been pulled over by the police or had a police confrontation? I mean, you know, I think I've been contacted at least a dozen times by police.
Well, I just got a ticket the other day.
You know, yeah, I mean, I'm trying to go through my mind. I'm like trying to do the math here. It's like, between speeding tickets, between, again, loud noise complaints in college. I mean, you know, what was John Roberts doing?
I agree.
What kind of life is that guy living?
Soaking his hands in ivory.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah. Before we, because the next thing I want to talk about, obviously, dovetails on illegal search. But did you see the other opinion that came out, which was the Hobbs Act, the robbery case, where they said this is the interstate commerce opinion, and they said essentially that drug dealer on drug dealer robbery was interstate commerce that they had the right.
No, tell me about this.
Oh my God! So you know what the Hobbs Act is? It's the where they allow you to if you commit a robbery and it affects interstate commerce, okay, then you can be prosecuted under this federal law.
What would be a prototypical example, like a hypothetical?
Ripping off a T-Mobile store,
okay,
or some sort of cell phone store or a jewelry store, anything, merchandise.
Sure, okay.
You do an armed robbery, and the feds have argued and successfully argued that if you affect interstate commerce, and typically, obviously, the flow of goods,
right,
has been held time and again to affect interstate commerce, and. But in this case, this was an issue that went up, and they had prosecuted a bunch of people under this Hobbs Act law for drug dealers robbing other drug dealers. Stash houses, that's
right. Right.
And so the court said that it's okay because the Interstate Commerce Clause does apply in this situation because only Congress has the power to regulate controlled substances and the flow of controlled substances. And so even though these are illegal controlled substances, Congress has the power to regulate that. So I understand the logic, but that's just kind of stupid. That's just really stupid. We're worried about drug dealers robbing other drug dealers.
We gotta make sure we're on top. We expand the Hobbs Act.
But yeah.
Drug dealers on drugs. That was one of the crazy
opinions. But I want to go to this Texas Supreme Court opinion because it deals with the same issue. Kind of we're talking about the legal stop and the violation of the Fourth Amendment. So the Texas Supreme Court, which is the civil side of things, not the Court of Criminal Appeals. Of course, recall that in Texas we have two courts, the highest courts. We have the Court of Criminal Appeals, which hears all criminal cases that come up from the Court of Appeals, and you have the Texas Supreme Court, which hears civil cases that come up from the Court of Appeals. So last week, not this week, but the week before, the Texas Supreme Court ruled that in civil asset forfeiture cases, that an illegal search is still good for asset forfeiture.
Fair game. So for the viewers, a civil forfeiture is when the asset you have may be considered contraband and therefore needs to be seized by the government and promptly turned over to the local DA's office for profit. No, I'm joking. But the officer sees the item and then sees it. They sell it. They auction it. They do whatever they do with.
Or they might use it for undercover if it's a car.
Right. Or undercovers. Or who was it? Was it the DA out in Nanawak? Or who was it? They're driving around in the seized Mercedes and Lexus. They get first dibs.
Yeah.
It's real nice. But so apparently, dealing with the exclusionary rule, the Texas Supreme Court said, no, the exclusionary rule, look, is for criminal cases, So if you have bad fruit or bad evidence, the fruit of the poisonous tree, that's going to protect you on the criminal side. And you know what? It doesn't apply to us taking your personal property. So you say it was a bad search. We say tomato. And we're going to take your Lexus that you're driving in, and you might win your criminal case and be free and walk the streets, but we're going to take that car that you were riding in. How that makes any sense, I don't know.
So what's crazy to me, and I understand the ruling, I understand the legal connection behind the ruling and how they got to the decision they did. I understand it. I don't agree with it. But essentially, they said that same 3823 instruction doesn't apply in civil cases because it's from the Code of Criminal Procedure. And so you don't have the use of that. You really don't have a mechanism like that in civil court to instruct a jury. So they're really, that's kind of, to me, what I understood is they really premised a lot of this on that whole. I mean, you read the opinion as well. Tell me if you agree, but I felt like they really came to their conclusion based on that. Like, oh, well, we don't have this in civil court, so I didn't feel like there was much hardcore reasoning behind it.
Well, I think it was, they went into a lengthy discussion on how the exclusionary rule is a judicial made rule. It's through the law. And yeah, you know, that clearly applies to the criminal case. But us judges over here aren't going to, the legislature left that part out of the statute. So
exactly.
It kind of seems like that us as judges aren't going to make, expand that rule. And if that's something that Congress should really look into doing.
Or the legislature.
Or the legislature should do it. You know, so this guy is cruising around in, I think it was a Lexus SUV.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, it was a Lincoln Navigator.
Lincoln Navigator.
Yeah.
Even better. Black, I think. And he's cruising around, and he gets pulled over, gets caught with some contraband. He wins his criminal case, and he strolls into the civil court thinking, I got this. This is mine. I can't wait to roll back in my Lincoln Navigator and go on about my business. And he loses. And the court says, no, too bad. And he screams at the top of his lungs and says, it was an illegal search. I mean, I was stopped illegally. All the stuff they got was illegal. I wasn't driving wrong. I didn't have a warrant. I wasn't speeding. The whole interaction between me and the cops was bogus, and therefore I should be able to get my stuff back. And the Texas Supreme Court said, nah.
The interesting thing, the quote that I said, they talked about what the Court of Appeals did, and they said that the Court of Appeals prematurely assumed that illegality equates to inadmissibility.
Oh, right. How could we miss that?
Yeah, I mean,
how could we miss that?
I don't know. I mean, I'm very frustrated by that, because again, you get to a point where if you win a criminal case, or you have the evidence thrown out, now essentially based on this ruling, let's say you do win at the criminal level, and you get it all thrown out, or even you get an acquittal, you're not getting your stuff back.
You're not getting your stuff back. That's amazing to me how you think you win, you are acquitted of the charge. You are not guilty.
Right.
Then they keep your stuff.
And that's not what this says. And just to be clear, that's not what this says.
Right.
But, you know, it's not that far off.
No, it's not.
It's really not that far off from saying, you know, just because you get acquitted. And look, arguably, they could have done that anyway.
Sure,
There's nothing to preclude a civil asset forfeiture, even in light of an acquittal.
Look at OJ.
Right. In criminal court, and you're absolutely right about that. So there's nothing on point or direct correlation, I should say, between an acquittal and civil liability.
Right.
So, but what this is saying is essentially, even if the cops screw up, you know, and do everything wrong, we're still going to take your stuff.
Well, and you know, in most people might say, well, what the big? Okay, so he loses the car. So you lose the $7,000 in cash and rubber in a rubber band you had in the trunk. Okay, dude. Okay, but what it comes into play is when in the big cases when they're taking your jet skis, they're taking all your second home, they're taking your cars, they're taking millions and millions of. I had this one. It was like a lot of homes. A lot of money, like a couple million in cash, like a lot. And they came in and were trying to take everything. And I thought, let's say a scenario like that, and you beat it on a motion to suppress.
Yeah.
In other words, judge says, you know what? We have fruit of the poisonous tree. The cops did something wrong. Law enforcement didn't follow the rules. Your rights were violated. I'm going to suppress all that evidence. The district attorney comes in on the back end, or the government comes in the back end, files a dismissal. And you say, I'm free and I won, but then you go back and everything that you have that you could possibly even have, other than I guess the things that are protected by law, which I don't think any of them are, if they're contraband, I don't think you can invoke the bankruptcy, like homestead kind of stuff when they're seizing all your stuff. Anyways, it's all gone. It's all gone, even if you win. Which is amazing to me.
And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, we've hit the 8:30 hour. Please call in with your questions and comments. 713-807-1794 is the number. It should be right there at the bottom of your screen. Also, at HCCLA_TV is our Twitter handle. I didn't see in here, and I couldn't find anywhere else, What happened with this guy's criminal case? Was he ever prosecuted, or did the DA pass on charges? Or
well, from what I gathered through reading it, was that
he was arrested. I know that.
Yeah. Okay. So
but I you can't tell from this whether he was actually ever prosecuted or not.
And you know, you're exactly right. When as I read it, it sounded like there was fruit of the poisonous tree. He won his criminal case.
Or he was never prosecuted.
You know, fair enough.
And that's what's unclear to me, because recall the debate we're having right now and the debate that's going on across the country, and I think they've done it in Pennsylvania, where they've said you have to have a criminal case in order to even bring a civil asset forfeiture case. Mm-hmm. We're not at that point in Texas. I mean, you don't have to file a criminal case in Texas for the government or the state to still come after your property. And in fact, a lot of times in federal courts, they'll initiate a asset forfeiture, a civil asset forfeiture proceeding well in advance of criminal charges. And so that's what I didn't understand here, was whether or not the illegal stop issue was actually litigated in criminal court. And found to be true there. So, I think that we should adopt some sort of rule like Pennsylvania just did, which is you got to at least bring a criminal case, or at least intend to bring a criminal case, make some sort of showing. Because I think it's silly that if you get the case thrown out on the criminal side, that the state should still be able to prosecute you.
You know, I remember.
If they don't bring it.
Right. I've had clients come in, and I typically see it out on Harwin, people, all counterfeit goods, burned goods, the spice or the
Kush.
The Kush.
Did you see that today? What happened?
No, what happened?
Speaking of, you throw that out there, but did you see all those? They had like a huge, like a dozen or more people were found in Herman Park with Kush overdoses, and they had like a trauma unit.
Are you just everybody going nuts in the middle of Herman Park? Park?
Yeah. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt your thought.
No, that's crazy.
Well, made me think of that.
Well, all these things usually on Harwin, they get all their stuff seized, and then they come to my office, and they're freaking out, and we're freaking out, not freaking out, but we're preparing for this huge criminal case that's about to come in, and we're telling them, look, all your stuff that they have decided to take is the least of your worries, because with the amount of Kush that you have and they took, and all the proceeds from that and all that stuff, you're about to get some real heavy charges. But they never bring the charges. I mean, occasionally they do, but it happens a lot where people come in, the government comes in, their stuff gets taken or seized, and the criminal charges never follow on the back end.
But explain to me this, though. How is it, I can understand how they argue that 3823 doesn't apply, and you know that you don't have, based on the Code of Criminal Procedure and everything, but how does the Fourth Amendment not apply in a civil case?
I didn't think that there were limitations as to when and where the Fourth Amendment should apply.
Exactly. I mean, that's what I'm really struggling with this opinion, is that if you want to argue that the code doesn't allow certain things, why did they not do an analysis of fundamental constitutional law and your Fourth Amendment right to be free from unreasonable searches and seizures?
You think
in the context of a civil case?
You think it?
I mean, you're clearly entitled to due process.
Yeah.
In a civil case.
You think maybe someone goofed and just didn't make that argument?
Don't know.
Came up with bad law. I hope not, and I'm not insinuating that whatsoever, but you'd like to think that in the alternative, if not the exclusionary rule, then we have this thing called the Fourth Amendment that should protect all of us.
But again, going back to what you said, the exclusionary rule and what they argued, of course, like we said before, the exclusionary rule is a judicial creature, all right? But how do you not even at least look at this from a pure Fourth Amendment analysis and do a pure Fourth Amendment analysis of this, you know?
I don't know. That's I didn't even think about that coming in, but I would like to think that, and usually the last sentence, judge, objection, because of XYZ. Oh, and also the Fourth Amendment to the United States, Texas and United States Constitution. And I would do the same thing in this brief. The last line I would say, and if all else fails, the Constitution. I mean, I would do a little bit more than that, but you'd like to think that that was a part of it.
Yeah, I mean, I have trouble because the exclusionary rule is, it's a creature of the Fourth Amendment, obviously. But to sit here and say that the exclusionary rule somehow shouldn't apply in a civil case is very troubling. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's almost as if they're saying that there's a distinction between which laws apply in a criminal case and which laws apply in a civil case.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's exactly what they're saying.
Mm-hmm.
It's not almost, it is. That's what they're saying. And I don't read the Constitution that way. Do you?
No, I do not. I do not read the Constitution.
The Constitution doesn't say this amendment applies in civil cases, this amendment applies in criminal cases.
You know, I'm starting to think, like, I'm trying to see the negotiation tactic. Look, okay, you know it's a bad fruit of the poisonous tree, prosecutor, but look, take his Lexus. How about we trade? You just dump the case now because we know you're going to, but you can take, how about you take the Lexus, you take the Rolex, you take the TVs, and we can just wash this up. It's a bizarre universe we're living in where an officer can pull you over and interact with you for any reason whatsoever and then run your, and then get your ID and run it, you know, one case. And then, you know what, imagine that scenario. And then they seize your car, and you can't even challenge the reason why they seized your car because they had no reasonable suspicion to pull you over in the first place.
It's a bad 2 weeks.
That's amazing.
This has been a bad 2 weeks.
God, I hope everybody realizes how bad this is.
I know, it's a bad 2 weeks.
When what they say also is, you know, and I'd like to touch on the immigration stuff.
Yeah.
On the way over here, and if anybody knows this, call, please, or text, or tweet.
And this was the opinion that came down today.
The immigration one.
Right.
Yes. So I was listening. So apparently President Obama was trying to implement to stop deportation and allow individuals who are here without status to at least gain some sort of status or work here and that scenario. Supreme Court said, Mr. Obama, your executive actions on immigration are paused because it was a tie. So essentially, you know, the executive action cannot move forward or they cannot proceed. So on the tails of that, the sheriff here was on public radio saying that he's going to go ahead and renew looking into sending individuals or referring individuals' names to ICE who are in custody. And he had kind of stopped doing that because of Obama's action, and they didn't know if what he was doing was legal or illegal or good policy or bad policy. But as of today, he's going to renew his the sending of names of individuals who have status or have been deported before or have immigration issues back on over to ICE. So this whole idea that, you know, Houston had a little bit of protection.
As a sanctuary city?
Yeah, as somewhat of a sanctuary city is now over, of some sort. And I was listening to it just as I was walking in, and it was really good. And if anybody knows about it, call in.
Do you think that's going to change whether or not people without legal status? Because before, as I understood it, there were a lot of people who did not have status that were getting bonds.
Right. I have plenty of them on bond.
Yeah.
I have plenty of them on bond.
You know, there was a time that they had put a hold on them.
Right.
And they couldn't get out. But then, you know, kind of along this whole sanctuary city line of where we supposedly were, people were getting bonds and getting out.
And not only getting bonds, but also not even getting hold because their name was never referred over to ICE.
So I wonder if, given the fact we're trying to reduce the jail population.
Oh, yeah. Well.
Are we going to go back to putting holds on people and keeping them there?
I don't know. I mean, I was listening to it and I said, oh, geez, this is going to be a, you know, problem in the sense where, you know, if you can make your bond before you got an ICE hold, and if it was part of it, the reason why was that the sheriff wasn't referring your name to ICE.
Right.
Well, now we're going to have a whole bunch of people in custody, and now we're going to have a whole bunch of people who.
I just wonder what ICE is actually going to do.
I don't know.
It's in limbo.
I got this, dude. I won't go into it, but yeah, they're letting people out who are not, who clearly have no status and who have some very bad crimes.
Let's go into a trial that you watched this week that happened right here. And it is the trial of four members of the Church of Wells who went into Lakewood Church, was it last year? I believe it was last year, and started heckling Joel Osteen, pastor of Lakewood Church, while he was in the middle of a sermon. And their case went to trial this week. They were charged with
trespass,
but then also public, was it some sort of public disorder or something like disorderly conduct, I think?
I thought there were, okay.
I know there was the trespass.
Right, I don't know if there was a companion charge to it, I don't know.
Yeah, because they one of them was dismissed.
Oh.
You wouldn't watch the trial, man.
I just wanted to watch the man.
You?
So let me tell you how he comes in.
Yeah, see, the trespass charges were dismissed, and they went, the jury decided the not guilty on disrupting a meeting or procession.
Ah.
Yeah.
I've never tried a case of disrupting a meeting or procession.
That's what it says.
So.
We'll have to ask John Stevenson and Brad Loper about this.
Of course they're invited to the church, Jimmy. Because my church is a place of worship. And people can come. Of course, I don't exclude them, Jimmy.
You're going to get some hate mail for this. You are going to get hate mail for this.
No.
Was that what he said?
Well, and part of it was, and I want to give big congrats to the lawyers who tried the case. He wouldn't condemn them. I mean, they tried, and he moved around, and he did his Joel Osteen thing, which was great, but. I think the fact that he never came out and said, you know, these guys shouldn't have been here. He kept coming back to, you know, I didn't know what was going on. Anybody at my church can scream and shout. I don't know if they're hostile or not. It sounded a little hostile, but I wasn't there. I couldn't really see. I just saw commotion. And I think the jury.
That was his testimony?
Yeah.
Well, that makes sense why the judge dismissed the trespass. If he said the church is open. How can you be trespassing?
Well, it was, I think they went on, they didn't go on the trespass?
No, the judge threw that out.
Then that's how they did it. I was wondering how they got the not guilty on the trespass. But I guess they went on the other case.
Well, no, the judge gave a directed verdict on the trespassing, and then that's what the jury found them not guilty on the disrupting.
Wow, that's how they did it. Because I just saw the cross of him and the cross.
Yeah, so I mean,
cross.
If you're, but if what you're saying is is what he said on the stand, I can see why the judge threw it out on the trespass, because if he said the church is open, how do you legally make a case for trespassing if we welcome everybody? How are you trespassing?
And I think, and at one point he said, you know, he quoted the scripture, you make a sound, a joyous sound for the Lord. And they were kind of going on that. And I get that now.
Well, how are you disrupting if everybody in church is yelling?
Making a joyous sound for God. I agree.
The backlash on social media by people, supporters of Lakewood Church, has been kind of ugly. They said these people should be in jail. They can't believe this verdict. And a lot of people view the Church of Wells as a cult.
Well,
and that's the issue here is a lot of people view them as a cult. They view Lakewood and Joel Osteen as a quote false prophet. And I guess this would have been a prime thing to ask Mark Bennett about a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, sure.
because these guys certainly have a free speech. Right.
Yeah.
To go in and say what they said.
It was the courtroom was packed. You had news cameras all around. And everybody was just on their tiptoes and on pins and needles to see the man. And I will go on the record. I've read many of his books. I'm a huge, fan of him, so when I heard he was in the courtroom, I ran to court.
Wait! You do an imitation of him, and now you're
like a fanboy. Because I think I'm a huge fan of him,
Okay.
But I had to see the man, so he floats in.
and floats.
Sits, yes, floats. Yeah. Like floated in, sits down.
Now, I want to ask you about that because he came in apparently through the back door.
Yes.
And not through the front door of the courtroom.
I think it was John Stevenson. I don't want to misquote. I think it was John. He says, "Yeah, and Mr. Osteen, you're coming in from judge's chambers, weren't you? Objection sustained." I mean, he was getting into all that. I mean, it was good. Great cross. You know, I mean, who can say they cross-examined Joe Osteen? I think, you know, and it was good. I'm a huge fan of him, though. I'm a huge fan. Huge fan. I honestly believed walking out of there that Osteen had charmed that jury. That jury, like I said, man, they're not, they're, man, I hope it comes out. I hope it's a fair and just verdict. And when it came back not guilty, I was very surprised.
Well, it doesn't sound like if Joel really wanted to be found guilty, he did himself any favors.
Well, and I think that was confused. I thought they were going on the trespass, not the other one, but it makes perfect sense now that the trespass got dumped and they got found not guilty on the other.
I mean, did the prosecutor not meet with him before the trial?
Well, okay.
What he was gonna say?
That's exactly what I was saying. you know, the cross-examination was, well, Mr. Osteen, I mean, some of it, it was much better than what I'm about to do. You know why you're here, don't you? And he says, yes. And you viewed the video, haven't you? And no. You haven't viewed the video? No. Okay, well, did you talk to security? No. Do you know often of when securities are moving people from your church? No.
This was the prosecutor asking you?
He's getting caught. This is the defense lawyers asking.
Oh, okay.
And I'm thinking to myself the same thing. Madam, or prosecution, didn't you, like, talk to him before he, you know, was here? Did you just, like, bring him to the back? And, like, where was the prep?
What do you think they called him for the star power? Because, I mean, if his testimony is he didn't hear them.
He didn't know. He just heard commotions. And
right.
He said he didn't know, and he couldn't, a couple rows, he can't see anything.
Because I wouldn't put that person on as a witness.
I really don't think they need, I don't necessarily think.
Why wouldn't you call the security guard?
They did.
Oh, they did? Well, why wouldn't you just leave it at that?
Because it's Osteen, man.
Well, but if he's not going to say they disrupted my sermon,
yeah,
and this is not, I mean, it seems to me that his testimony should have been, not that you want to, he told the truth. He told the truth. Okay. But if his testimony is not something to the effect of, I heard them, they were disrupting my sermon, why would you put that witness on?
It's almost like he couldn't. He went up to the line and said, you know, I heard something. They were getting escorted out. I heard commotion. And he couldn't condemn the four men down there. And I don't know if that's something like, you know, what would Jesus do kind of thing. I don't know. It was very interesting. It's very, very good to see him. He's actually quite small. He's short.
He's not tall like you?
No, you know, you see him and you think he's a giant. He's short. He's not a big guy.
He's got a giant persona, Julio.
Well, it,
giant persona.
The wings took up most of the courtroom.
Real quickly, I want to get a little news item in here. Got more problems with breathalyzer machines here in the Houston area. So
huge problem.
Do not plead any DWIs until you find out. If you were in the League City area, southeast Harris County, Galveston County.
Seabrook.
Yeah, all the
South Houston.
Southeast side corridor. Mm-hmm. Another, and this is the same area that got hit before with a bad intox operator.
Basically, down Southeastern 45 down to Galveston, anything in that whole area, if you get pulled over for a DWI, well, now I'd imagine they're fixing that, but you got pending cases. This goes for lawyers and watchers. You put that case on pause, and I don't know if we're having enough time to talk much all about it, but we need, and if you're a lawyer out there and know something about this, because this is breaking, we need you to come on the show and help educate us. Apparently, you have a technical supervisor out there, and I didn't know this, but apparently, and correct me if I'm wrong, the technical supervisor who actually owns the machine in these smaller counties, and they lease it to, you know, the cities. And so when a maintenance issue has to come up, they go and repair the machines themselves. It's like, you know, I have five air conditioners, and I'm the maintenance guy on them too, and I'm leasing them to all kinds of to different people or venues. Same thing with the tech supervisor, from what I understand. I could be completely wrong, but this is what I was told today. And so when she would go and try to repair the instruments, apparently she didn't know what she was doing.
Yeah, I mean, the crux of it is there was an internal investigation, found her results were not up to par, and they booted her. So bottom line, guys, don't plead your cases if you're down in that area. Be sure you get the Brady notice on, what's her name? Nelly Martinez.
Nelly.
Go from there.
Whoa, Nelly.
Before we get out of here, Julio, what's in a name?
Everything?
Well, apparently if you're South Texas at college.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
I got to mention it in the last couple minutes because both of us are graduates of the now former, I guess, deceased South Texas College of Law name.
I wonder when we're going to stop putting, it's Houston College of Law, formerly South Texas.
It's like the artist formerly known as Prince.
I know. You know, and apparently somebody studied this a whole lot more and got paid a whole lot more money for this opinion.
So for those of you who don't know what's going on, South Texas College of Law, which has been the downtown Houston Law School, which both Julio and I graduated from, as well as a number of members of the Harris County Criminal Lawyers Association, a number of ADAs both in Harris County and the surrounding area, and a number of solo and small firm practitioners. They changed the name without any notification really to anybody. And now it's Houston College of Law.
Red and white.
Red and white. And shockingly, the University of Houston is threatening to file a lawsuit for infringement. Like, who didn't see that one coming?
Yeah, I go to Houston College of Law. You mean UH? No.
The other one.
The other one.
That's not going to cause confusion at all.
You know, and they said, you know, well, the research suggested that we needed to include the word Houston. So how about South Texas College of Law, Houston? Maybe. I don't know. Look.
I'm not happy with it.
I'm going to go on the record and say, this better work. I'm going to support it, but this better work.
Remember what The Rock said?
Do you smell what he's cooking?
No, know your role. Know your role, South Texas. Know your role. Anyway, that's all the time we got this week, ladies and gentlemen. Next week, we have Rob Fickman confirmed as one of our guests. He's going to be here to help promote HCCLA's courthouse reading of the Declaration of Independence in celebration of our upcoming 4th of July holiday. So I hope you will join us next week to hear all that Rob has to say and find out all about the upcoming declaration reading. For Julio Vela, I'm Jimmy Ardoin. We'll see you next Thursday night. Good night, everybody.